Good morning. And welcome to Amelia Methodist Church. We are glad you are here with us this morning and online. So would everyone at this point stand and welcome your neighbor? Okay, announcements this morning. Youth group this evening. This is a time change only for tonight. It'll be at 5:30 instead of 5 p.m. The Rebecca Circle is still taking reservations for the Mother's Day luncheon on May 13. And the interparish ministry food traveling mobile thing is going to be here on May 17, and we are still taking volunteers for that out in the Narthex. Any other Except Ed announcements? Now Ed has an announcement.
Just a couple quick reminders. Women's Bible study starting Friday morning. This Friday morning at, what time is it, 9:30? Okay, and they'll be studying the whole armor of God. If you haven't gotten your book, or if they haven't got it, or you haven't got it ordered, see Sylvia. Sylvia, stand up for a moment so they can see who you are. See Sylvia, and she will make sure you get a book. So be sure and do that today so that you can be there Friday morning. Tuesdays and Thursdays, we're studying 1 Timothy, so come, be a part of it. Tonight, we'll be in our third session of the How Shall We Then Live series, which will be on lesson 5 and 6, but it's a good place to start if you have not been with us up to now. This is a good starting place in, because it starts to move in a direction, so we trust that you'll come. It's a really important study. And we have some good discussion, and we trust that you'll be there. That's tonight, 6:30, so plan on that as well. So those are our studies for this week. So,
okay, so why don't we at this point in time welcome the Holy Spirit into our worship for a moment of silent prayer. Our reading from Scripture today is from Psalm chapter 37, verses 1 through 4. Do not fret because of evil men or be envious of those who do wrong, for like the grass they will soon wither, like green plants they will soon die away. Trust in the Lord and do good, dwell in the land and enjoy safe pasture. Delight yourself in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. This is the word of God for the people of God. Praise be to God. And now if we'll all stand and join in singing with the praise band. Thank you.
One, two, three.
I know a place where we can go to lay your troubles out, eating your soul. I know a place where mercy flows, take the stain, make you whiter than snow. Like a tide, it is rising up deep inside a current that moves and makes troubles like living water that brings a deadly life.
Down to the river, down to the river.
Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. We're asked to have prayer for David, who has shingles. So let's remember this, David in prayer. Pray at 4 today for the Cornerstone United Methodist Church in Portsmouth. They're going to be taking their vote on disaffiliation at 4 o'clock today, and they've asked that we pray for the church there. I pastored that church. Actually, we built that church way back quite a few years ago. Prayers for Terry's older brother, Gene. He suffers from macular degeneration, and he's losing his eyesight. So we pray for him during this time of adjustment. They're also asking prayers for Gene's granddaughter, Lacey Knapp. They've asked for prayers for her in the past because she had a brain tumor. The doctors felt confident that it was benign prior to surgery. After surgery and pathology reports, it's been found to be cancerous. So at this time, the doctors are unsure of her treatment. Could potentially be a very rare type of cancer. So let's be remembering Lacey in our prayers as well. Are there any unspoken requests you want to indicate with the lifted hand this morning? God knows what they are. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, you are God. And Lord, the name of Jesus does keep us singing as we go, because he's our Savior and our King, Lord. We realize, Lord, we would have no access to you without Jesus. We come through him and in his name. He is the bridge between you and us. We're thankful that he died for us and that he rose again. And Father, we just come in his name. He's our Lord. He's our Savior. We're thankful, Lord, that as we come to you, we know that you hear our prayers. You told us you would. And so, Father, we bring these to you that need a healing touch this morning. You know them by name, and you know their difficulties. Reach out your hand, we pray. Touch them. And Lord, bring healing. You're the great physician. We do pray for Cornerstone Church and the other churches all over our conference, Lord, that are taking votes to disaffiliate. Many of them have already taken their votes. Others have theirs yet to come. May your spirit be upon them, Lord, we pray. And your will be done among them, Father. And Lord, we pray for the upcoming conference that the conference will vote to allow those churches to disaffiliate, Lord. So that, Lord, we can stand for you in spirit and truth and stand by your word. We pray that you would place your hand upon it, Lord. We want to be right in the middle of your will, Father, wherever that will takes us. And Lord, I know that our brethren in these churches want the same. So help them, we pray, and give them wisdom. Father, we bring our cares to you, knowing that you know us all by name, and you know all of the difficulties in our lives. You know every burden, every care that we carry. And right now, Lord, we just cast them on you. You told us if we cast our cares on you, that you would bear us up. So, Father, we just look to you. Give us faith to trust you and to believe. And, Lord, may we walk in accordance to that which you say to have spoken to us. We ask it, Lord, in the name of Jesus, who is our King and our Savior. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. Children are dismissed for junior church at this time, kids. Little kids go downstairs and big kids turn to Luke 12, okay? We'll turn to Luke chapter 12. And I'm going to begin reading with verse 22 instead of verse 13. Luke 12:22. Listen to the word of the Lord. Then Jesus said to his disciples, "Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, or about your body, what you will wear. Life is more than food, and the body more than clothes. Consider the ravens. They don't sow or reap. They have no storeroom or barn, yet God feeds them. And how much more valuable you are than birds. Who of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to his life? Since you cannot do this very little thing, why do you worry about the rest?
Consider how the lilies grow. They don't labor or spin. Yet I tell you, not even Solomon in all of his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, how much more will he clothe you, O you of little faith? And do not set your heart on what you will eat or drink. Don't worry about it. For the pagan world runs after all these such things. And your Father knows that you need them. But seek his kingdom, and these things will be given to you as well. Do not be afraid, little flock, for your Father has been pleased to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give to the poor. Provide purses for yourselves that will not wear out, a treasure in heaven that will not be exhausted, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Let us pray. Father in heaven, give us wisdom. Give us understanding. Teach us this morning, we pray. Father, open your word, lead us to the truth. And Lord, may we get our lives focused on the things that really matter. Holy Spirit, be upon us, direct us. We can do nothing without you. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. This is off, isn't it? I'm going to move it if it's all right. It's distracting. That's better. It casts a shadow on my Bible so that I'm looking in light and then shadow. That's not a good thing. Although I think it was C.S. Lewis that says that we live in the shadow lands, the shadows of the kingdom, and there is something to that. In our Sunday school class this morning, we discussed, the youth did, actually, I do most of the talking, but the youth do contribute some. Fancy that, huh? It's kind of like Bible study, isn't it? But they came up with the word. And they came up with the word hypocrite. Because Jesus was talking about, the people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. And the thing we prayed for the congregation this morning, as the youth prayed over every, they pray over every pew. Some start in the back, some in the front, and we do the same here, and they meet in the middle. And we pray over the pew. And the thing we prayed was that our worship would be authentic. Because Jesus said about them, they honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me, therefore their worship is in vain. Doesn't count. Because they're not worshiping sincerely. They're just uttering words. Unfortunately, we all probably get caught in that once in a while. In worship. The kids pointed out a couple things. One, that the preacher could preach, these kids are honest, his own thoughts rather than the word of God. That would be a problem. And so we have to pray. Realizing that those of us who are teachers or preachers, no matter what level we teach or preach on, have to be very careful because the things we say have consequences in people's lives. So it better be true. It better be in accordance to the truth and the word of God. Another thing they pointed out, one of the kids pointed out, said, well, we have to be careful about the words in the songs as well. Whether or not they're really based on truth. because some words are accurate, some are inaccurate. And music has a way of sticking in our minds, and we can easily learn false things through music. Truth. Setting our hearts on the right thing. Jesus said to the woman at the well, the worshipers God desires are those who worship him in spirit and in truth. In other words, they really mean it. They do it with spirit. They do it with what's inside of them, and their worship is true worship. It's what it ought to be, and they're into it. Traditional, contemporary doesn't help us there, because they could both be the way. It could be sincere from the heart and traditional worship, or it can be just going through the routines of what we've always known. And contemporary is the same way. Just because it's new doesn't mean that it's true. And just because it's new doesn't mean that we worship it actually using the words and that we're into it. We got to be into it. We got to mean what we're saying. Our heart is what really matters here. And the passage that we were looking at is the passage where he talks about that it's not what comes into our hearts, it's what comes out of our mouths that defiles us. Because the mouth, what comes out, shows us what's inside. That's why the Bible tells us we need to, things that are honest, things that are good, things that have good repute, things that are true. Those are the things we should be thinking about and filling our lives with, because it will spill out. And so it raises the question, what are you filling your life with? What are you filling your heart with? Because my class is the teens. I pointed out, if you fill yourself with only silly stuff and goofy stuff you get from the internet and YouTube and TikTok and all this nutty stuff, if you fill your heart with that, then you will become silly people. But it's not just youth, it's teen, it's adults as well. What do we fill ourselves with? Because that's what we will become. Do we fill ourselves with the highest, the best? Where's our heart? Jesus even talks here in the passage about our life and what we focus our life on. What are we focusing our life on? There's a passage of scripture. I remember Dr. Ravenhill way back in 1973 or something. I heard him preach, and I still remember the sermon. And the phrase especially that he used, the title was, "What is your life?" Now, guys, he didn't say, "What is your wife?" That could be interesting, I guess. He said, "What is your life? What is it you're living for?" One of the great poets of England who was known in his life. A lot of times poets don't become really famous until after they die. But he was acclaimed everywhere. He was a very handsome man, and the women swooned, and he had all the women that he wanted. He was welcomed into king's courts. His name was Lord Byron. And Lord Byron had it all. He had fame, he had wealth, he had all the women that he wanted. His life was pretty decadent. He had everything that we grasp for. And yet when he came to die, he reached for his pen and he wrote a last phrase. He says, "My life is in the yellow leaf. The joys of life are gone. The worm, the canker, and the grief are mine alone." Well, that's something to live for, isn't it? Wasn't it Thoreau that said, "I went into the woods because I didn't want to come to the end of my life and discover that I had never really lived. I wanted to suck the marrow out of life. What are you living for? Jesus here says, your life's not about eating and drinking and the things that you wear. And yet that seems to preoccupy most of our time, doesn't it? What would be interesting to see where our heart is to ask ourselves a couple questions. One, what do I spend all my time on? Where does my time go to? And the second question, I remember someone saying, all you have to do is check somebody's checkbook, or in our day, just their bank account, and I can tell you where their heart is. When I look and see what they spend their money on. Dr. Ravenhill always said that, let me spend 10 minutes in prayer with someone and I can tell you how spiritual they are. What are we living for? Jesus says, consider the ravens. They don't toil or reap, and yet God feeds them. Or consider the lilies of the field. They don't sow, they don't toil, and yet God clothes them in a beauty that even Solomon never was able to reach in all of his glory. And then he tells us simply this, that if God takes care of the birds and the flowers like that, you're far more important than a bird or a flower. Don't you think he could take care of you? And he coins that little phrase in there, O ye of little faith. Jesus seems to put it as a faith issue. What is it that we pursue in life? What do we spend our time on? It seems to me we occupy ourselves with making money and buying things, storing up things for the future. And that seems to preoccupy our time. But Jesus says, no, don't do that. That's what the pagans do. That's what our culture does. That's what the non-believers do. That's the focus of their lives, making money, buying as much as they can, shopping till they drop, entertaining themselves to death. I remember Neil Postman wrote a pretty good book called Amusing Ourselves to Death, talking about our nation. We're entertaining ourselves to death. We have to be entertained every moment. Is that what life's about? Jesus says, no. He says, that's not what life's about at all. He said, instead, you should be focused on seeking the kingdom of God. Seek first the kingdom of God. That verse is used in another passage where he says, seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And then everything else will be taken care of. God will take care of us if we focus on the kingdom. And yet we worry and we give ourselves ulcers and all, trying to scrape out a so-called living. We've got an image of living. I'm not sure that it's a godly living. It's certainly a pagan way of living. We don't pursue that which is high, but that which is low. And we don't have time for the things of the kingdom of God as a result. I often think about that when I think of things like Bible studies and stuff like that. I think, you know, I'm a preacher. Everybody's supposed to be there, right? Because I wonder, well, what are they spending their time on then? If we're not pursuing the things of God, what are we spending our time on? Well, you could say, well, we're out there witnessing to people. Yeah, if we were doing that, the church would be filled with the people we were winning to the Lord. That isn't happening. And we pushed for people to invite people for Easter Sunday. How many of you actually invited your neighbors to church on Easter Sunday? You did. Good. I actually had one come. So what is it that we're spending our time on? I can remember one of the bishops, when he retired, he made this comment. He said, if I had it to go back and do over again, I would have played more golf. And I thought, what a fool. Obviously, his heart wasn't in the right place. Where's your heart? What is it you're living for? What is it that you're making the focus of your life? Is it the kingdom of God and the righteousness of God? Is that what we're focused on? I can remember back when I was a kid, usually it was in the South, but I can remember being at with my grandma and grandpa and uncles. Actually, they were great uncles. I can remember being at Uncle Omer, Uncle Herman, and Aunt Ernestine's house, and all the men who were all preachers, pretty much. But everybody was sitting around in their white long sleeve white shirts and their ties, and Florida in the middle of the summer. And they probably had their coats on too. Because back then, when I was a kid in the South, especially, at least with my grandma, a preacher always wore a white shirt and a tie all the time. And my grandpa would even mow the lawn in a white shirt and tie in Florida. But they would be sitting around talking about spiritual things, talking about biblical things. The discussion would revolve around those kinds of things. Well, most of the time when we get together, we're talking about trivial things that don't matter, like the Bengals and the Reds. I mean, listen, what occupies our conversations when we're together? Our chit-chat. Those are things that seem to grab our hearts. What's on our hearts? Where's your heart? And what is your life focused on? That's the question here. Because what you pursue as your treasure, that's where your heart's going to be. And the question Jesus is raising is, are you focused on the kingdom of God and the righteousness of God? Or are you worried about what you're going to eat and drink? And that's such a temptation for us. Somebody asked me once, who do you like better, Mary or Martha? You know the story of Mary and Martha. Mary's sitting at the feet of Jesus. Martha's busy trying to get lunch and, you know, busy doing all these things. She once tells Jesus, well, my sister's just sitting there. Tell her to come help me. And Jesus says, Martha, Mary's chosen the better thing of the two. You're worried about much stuff over here that you don't need to be. But somebody asked me, which one do you like best? And so the obvious answer was, are you talking before dinner or after dinner? Right? I mean, before dinner, I might like Martha a lot. She's getting the dinner, right? But you can see the point Jesus is trying to make even in that story is that Mary's chosen the better thing. She's pursuing the kingdom. She's pursuing that which is of God. And yes, the dinner needs to be made, but it'll get done. What occupies our time? What do you spend your time on? Is it pursuing the kingdom? It'd be nice just to have a group of us sit down with cups of coffee and let's talk about the kingdom of God. Let's talk about the things of God. Let's talk. That's why when Bible studies, when people ask their questions that get us off track, which is if you've ever been in our Bible studies, we get off track. And that doesn't bother me at all. We're not on a time frame. And when else do people get a chance to ask their questions? When else do we sit down in a logical way and actually discuss things? Talk about things of the kingdom. Talk about the things, the questions in our hearts and our doubts, our fears. And actually talk and pursue the kingdom. Kingdom things matter. Jesus puts it into perspective here. He said, you worry about all these other things, and yet your worrying doesn't change anything. By worrying, we can't add a single hour to our lives. In fact, our modern medicine and stuff would tell us that by worrying, we might detract hours from our lives. Because it can cause all kinds of illnesses and psychological problems that can actually detract. Jesus says, you don't need to worry about those things. God will take care of us. And that raises the question, do we believe that God can take care of us? Or do we think we have to do it ourselves? That's a real issue. Can I trust God with my life? Or do I think I have to do it all? Where's your heart? Because that's where your treasure will be. And if your treasure is of earthly things, Jesus points out to us here in the passage, those things will fade away and decay. And that's why he tells us, store up things in the kingdom, in heaven, eternal things. Those are eternal. Those will last. The things of this world don't last. So don't focus your life on them. They won't be there down the road. Those things don't last. It's the wrong thing to focus on. Right ahead of this passage is the parable of the rich fool. He was a man who had a great crop. He'd made a lot of money. He had a crop. He was bountiful. And so he said, I'm going to build barns and store it in a barn. And then I'll be able to just quit and retire and eat, drink, and be merry and enjoy all of this. And Jesus said, you're a fool. If that's where you put your treasure, tomorrow your life will be taken away. And then where is it? Then what is all of that? It decays, it leaves, it breaks down. This world is not eternal. It decays. And Jesus says, don't lay your treasure where there's moth and rust can decay it, where thieves can break in and steal it. He says, instead, put your treasure in heaven where it's eternal and nothing can take it away. Because where your heart, where your treasure is, that's where your heart's going to be. It's kind of like what we feed into ourselves. That's what will come out of us. What I put in will come out. And that's what can destroy me. I remember Tom Hermes, the president of World Gospel Mission at one time. He's the head of the, he's the general secretary of the Church of Christ Christian Union right now. He's the head of the whole thing. But Tom, telling the story once in one of my churches, he was preaching for me. And he told a story. He was a preacher's kid. And one time it was a Saturday and the ball game was on. He was watching the ball game, but he had to get his bath for church the next day. And so his dad told him to go up, and it was in the ninth inning, and go ahead and get his water for his bath so that he could get his bath as soon as the game was over. So he went up and turned on the water and let it start running. Then he came down to watch the end of the ninth inning. And wouldn't you know it, somebody hit a home run, tied the game. And he said somewhere about the 12th or 13th inning, he heard his father yell, and he goes running, and there's water coming down the steps of the hall into that parsonage, and down the steps. And he learned a lesson very quickly. You could only feel something so full, and it begins to spill out. He said that parsonage, he was back at it, still has the water stains on the carpet down the steps. But it was a lesson he had to learn. What are you filling your life with? Because that's what will come out down the road. What are you pursuing in life? We tell our teens the wrong things, it seems to me. We tell them, make sure you go to college and get you a good degree so that you can go out and get you a good job and make a good living and make lots of monies. We don't tell them, make sure that whatever you do, you're walking in obedience to God. I'd rather have my child only work at McDonald's and be walking in obedience to God than to have a job where they make lots of money. Because in the end, that's all that's going to matter. We all want to come to the end of our life and be able to hear God say to us, "Well done, good and faithful servant." You walked in obedience. And what he says to each of us will be different, because we're all servants. We're all called to different things. And the key will be, am I walking in obedience to God? Is obeying God and being a part of the kingdom of God and becoming holy and righteous like Jesus is holy and righteous, is that what I pursue in my life? Because that's what makes the difference. Jesus said, seek first the kingdom and his righteousness. And God will supply our needs. We're more valuable than birds or plants. God will supply our needs. And so he says to them here, he said, sell your possessions, give them to the poor, follow me. That's what he asked all of the disciples to do. Leave whatever you're doing, come follow me, and I'll take care of you. Pursue the kingdom, and they did. And we honor them for it. What is God calling you to do? Is your mind focused on the things of God? Are you living for the things of God? Or are you pursuing things that are going to fade away and not going to amount to anything? This is important to us because this is our life. And you and I only have one life to live. We don't reincarnate. I did actually meet a guy who had come. He was his mother had died, and supposedly, and he needed money so he could get up there. He was wanting money from me and stuff, and I gave him some money and sent him on his way. The next year, the same guy came to me, and his mother had died, and I looked at him and I said, "Is your mother a Hindu? I mean, is she reincarnating or what is happening here? Because she died last year and you asked me for money." And so, of course, I sent him on his way that time. So other than that lady, I don't know of anybody. We only have one life. What are you going to live it for? Are you going to pursue the things that matter? Are you going to store up the treasure in heaven, the things of God, pursuing his kingdom and his righteousness? In the end, it's the only thing worth living for. As Solomon says, everything else will be vanity and meaningless. It's the only thing worth pursuing. Nothing else will last. Where's your heart? And what is your heart centered on? And that makes all the difference in the world, because where your heart is, that's where you'll build your treasure. It's kind of like we've seen on Linda's pointed out that she liked in the Schaefer videos. What a man thinks, that's what he'll do. That's how he'll live. As a man thinketh, so goes he. And what he focuses his heart on and treasure, that's how he's going to live his life. Where's your heart? And what's it centered on today? Father in heaven, we're thankful. Jesus warns us not to center our lives on things that don't matter. But Lord, that we'd center on you and the things that you have done, and on your kingdom and your righteousness. And Lord, the things that are about your life, those need to be the fruit of our lives, that we might be like you and that we might be really kingdom people. Focus our hearts on those things, Lord. Teach us not to worry about the other stuff, Lord. You'll take care of it, Lord. May we follow you. And may we obey you. And may Jesus be the focus of our life. We pray it, Lord, in your name. Amen. Let's stand together and join our closing hymn.
I am the Lord of sea and sky. I have heard my people cry. I am the Lord of heart and sin. My hand will sing. I'm waiting.
Father in heaven, as we leave this place, may we walk in the Spirit, Lord. May we live our lives, Lord, with our eyes focused on your kingdom and your righteousness, that we might become kingdom people and that Jesus would be reflected in our lives. Lord, may we store up our treasure in heaven. We pray it in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you.